All right, there's one instruction I want to give you as we proceed to the final stage of this case. This case, I would refer to as the insanity phase, and you're going to receive this instruction at the end, but I also want to review it with you at the beginning so you know what the issues for your determination are in this phase of the case. The defendant has entered a plea of not guilty by reason of insanity to the six now convictions that stand in this case. Under the laws of the state of New Hampshire, a person who is insane at the time he acts is not criminally responsible for his conduct. The defendant has raised the defense of insanity. Insanity is an affirmative defense. This means that the defendant has the burden of proving by clear and convincing evidence that he was insane at the time of these crimes. Clear and convincing evidence is evidence that the thing to be proved is highly probable or reasonably certain. In this case, the defendant must prove that it is highly probable or reasonably certain that he was insane at the time of the criminal acts on October 12th of 2019. The defense of insanity is essentially a claim that the defendant is not criminally responsible for the acts he committed. By raising a defense of insanity, the defendant says that he suffered from a mental illness or disease, also referred to as a mental defect, which made him not responsible for his actions at the time he acted on October 12, 2019. There is no legal standard to determine whether or not the defendant suffered from an illness or disease which rendered him not responsible for his actions at the time he acted. Whether or not any such mental illness or disease exists is for you to decide. There is no simple test to use in deciding whether the defendant was insane at the time of these crimes. Insanity is merely a question of fact to be decided by you on all the evidence in the case. The testimony of expert psychologists or psychiatrists may be considered by you, but the testimony of lay people may be considered as well. And the ultimate question of insanity is for you and not for the psychological or psychiatric experts that you'll hear from in this case. In deciding whether the defendant was insane, you may consider any evidence of insanity. For instance, whether the defendant was suffering from delusions or hallucinations, whether the defendant knew the difference between right and wrong, whether the defendant acted impulsively or acted with cunning and planning in executing these six crimes. You may consider other symptoms, such as whether the defendant could recognize friends or manage his own affairs at the time. None of these, however, is a test for insanity, but you may consider all of these things. The basic question you must decide is whether the defendant should be held responsible for the acts as a criminal, or whether he should be found not responsible as a criminal for his acts and treated as a person suffering from a mental illness or disease at the time he committed these offenses. I'll give you the balance of the instruction after the evidence has been presented, but that's just to give you a preview of what you're going to be considering so you understand this particular final phase of the trial. All right, with those preliminary instructions reviewed with you, we'll now proceed to this phase of the trial. In this phase of the trial, unlike the first phase of the trial, the defendant has the burden of proving that he was insane by clear and convincing evidence. The state does not have the burden of proof in this phase of the trial. As a result, with respect to the opening statements, you would go first, Mr. Holloway. Are you prepared to do that?
Yes, Your Honor.
Very good. So we'll turn to Mr. Holloway for his opening statement. Go right ahead.
Okay, so now this is the third phase of this trial. I can finally be honest about more of my life, more honest and more open. did what you were supposed to do in the guilt phase. The first phase, you did what you were supposed to do. You were all United States citizens. I believe you're impartial jurors. I believe that you will make the right decision. It doesn't matter to me. All I know is I protected my mother. Everything else is irrelevant. I won't even care what happens. I enjoyed the life that I did have. I was born August 6, 1982. I had fun as a kid, even though it was dangerous. I know a lot of people. A lot of people know me. You'd be shocked and amazed if I told you some of the fun times that I've had. You'd be shocked and amazed if I told you some of the crazy times that I've had. This is life. You only get one. I'm not retarded. No offense to anybody with retardation. I have a retarded cousin. My cousin Pookie, R.I.P. She died. I love her very much. I never teased her, never picked on her. She's from Ohio. But I'm not retarded. I was in special ed classes. But I don't think it was for not being smart enough. I was always a smart kid. My grandfather used to make me spell everything. He'll pick something off the floor. Hey, spell this. He'll pick something off the wall when we riding by on the highway. Spell that. And I'd spell it correctly. Because I like to learn. But was I a bad kid? Yeah, I was. I got spanked for everything. My father spanked me for everything. My mother would tell you that again. For the most part, this phase is about whether or not I suffered a mental illness or defect at the time of the crime, October 12, 2019. Did I suffer a mental illness or defect at that time? I'm going to show you that I did. I suffered several of them. And I don't know how to control them all. Not even one of them. I can't control one, let alone if I had 5, 6, or 7, or 8, and all at the same time, under the depression and everything that I was going on at that time of the crime, at that time. I can't tell you how I would be able to stay calm when my mother's in danger, when I'm suffering from so much and I changed and I had a better life and I was doing so good. And then, boom, something's going on, something's wrong with my mother. I don't have a choice. I didn't have a choice. Like I said earlier, I probably died 3 times. I'll die for my mother. I don't care what anybody says. I will die for my mother today, tomorrow, the next day. It doesn't matter to me. All I know is that I tried my best in my life. You only get one life. I tried my best. No matter what I was suffering from, no matter what I've been through, I've been jumped by 5 people 3 times, if you know what that means. I've been shot at. I've been stabbed. I've been through so much that you wouldn't even understand. There's not a movie that can tell you about my life. There's not a movie that can display what I've been through. I'm still alive. I'm 41. I think. Or am I 42? I don't know. I stopped counting my birthdays because I'm locked up so much. I'm always in the joint. My mother's tired of me going to jail. She's tired of me calling from jail. Everybody's going to tell you that I'm crazy. Everybody's going to say, oh, that's my crazy cousin. Or, but they'll never tell you that I didn't do something that would be totally bad against a regular person. I don't just harm people. That's not my life. I save people. I might think myself as a hero. What's wrong with me being a hero? Does people doubt? Do people doubt that I'm a hero? Do people doubt that? I know that I saved a lot of lives. I know that I saved a lot of people from dangers. But most of my family suffers from PTSD, depression, anxiety. My mother herself suffers from mental illnesses. My father suffers from mental illnesses. I was born into mental illnesses. My family has mental illnesses. Both of my grandparents have died for mental illnesses. There's no way you're not going to find me sane at the time of this crime. You had my mother hypnotized. She wouldn't listen to nothing I had to say. So whatever the description of that incident is, had to be resulted or caused by one of my mental illnesses. At least one of them. I don't know which one to tell you was the main one that was activated. I don't know. But I don't even care because my mother's safe today. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Holloway, and Attorney Dobieski for the state.
Thank you. Dale Holloway wasn't insane on October 12, 2019. Dale Holloway wasn't insane. He was grieving. The evidence that you will hear during this phase of trial that will be presented to you will show that the defendant, Mr. Holloway, was not insane at the time he committed the crimes that he has now been convicted of on October 12, 2019. And as the judge reminded you prior to opening statements, the burden is not on the state, ladies and gentlemen. Mr. Holloway has the burden of proof here. And it's not a burden of proof, as you heard the judge say, it's a burden of proof. Highly probable that he was suffering from a mental disease and defect at the time. But it's not just the fact, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Holloway doesn't have to prove to you that he was merely suffering from a mental disease and defect. No. Mr. Holloway has to prove to you that that mental disease or defect the acts that he committed on October 12, 2019 were the product of that mental disease and defect. And so Mr. Holloway in his opening explained to you that, you know, he suffered from a variety of mental diseases and defects. But under the burden of proof and the standards here, just suffering from a mental disease and defect, ladies and gentlemen, that's not enough for the defendant to meet his burden. He has to show that the acts on October 12, 2019 were a product of that mental disease and defect. Keep that in mind when you're listening to the evidence. Now, as I've said ad nauseum during this opening statement, Mr. Holloway has the burden of proof. Even so, the state's going to present evidence. The state's going to present witnesses, and you're going to hear those witnesses. You'll hear evidence regarding interactions the defendant had with individuals, interactions he had before October 12, 2019, and interactions he had after October 12, 2019. And that evidence is really simple. It'll show that the defendant's actions at the New England Pentecostal Church on October 12, 2019, they weren't the product of a mental illness he was suffering from. Notably, ladies and gentlemen, the state will call an expert. You're going to hear from Dr. Shannon Baber. And she'll tell you that, in her expert opinion, the defendant's actions on October 12, 2019, they weren't the product of a mental illness. Dale Holloway wasn't insane on October 12th. He was just grieving. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Holloway, your first witness, please.
Your Honor, I would like to call Dr. Stephanie Tabashneck.
All right, we'll get Dr. Tabashneck. Raise your right hand. Do you
swear the testimony you're about to give will be the truth and nothing but the truth under the pains and penalties of perjury?
I do.
You may proceed.
Thank you.
Go right ahead, Mr. Holloway.
Good afternoon, Dr. Tabashneck.
Good afternoon.
Could you please spell your name for the jurors?
Yes, Stephanie, S-T-E-P-H-A-N-I-E, Tabashneck, T-A-B-A-S-H-N-E-C-K.
And what is your profession?
I'm a forensic psychologist and an attorney.
And when you say forensic psychologist, what do you actually do?
I work at the intersection of psychology and the law. I do forensic evaluations that are court-related.
Okay, and you do forensic evaluations at... Can you give me a brief description of your background, where you studied, and how long have you been studying?
Yes, I attended Michigan State University for my undergraduate degree, where I majored in social policy and psychology. I received a master's and doctoral degree from the Massachusetts School of Professional Psychology in clinical psychology, and I completed a law degree at Northeastern University School of Law, and then a postdoctoral fellowship at the Center for Children, Families, and the Law.
So you have a good understanding about kids with mental problems and mental health issues?
I would say I have training and experience in evaluating children with mental health issues, yes.
Okay, thank you. And at some point, did you get a chance to evaluate me?
Yes.
And what were your diagnoses of that evaluation?
Your Honor, before we get, I'm going to object just briefly.
Sure.
I'm assuming Mr. Holloway just needs to certify the expert. I certainly have no objection, but I think foundation-wise, we should do that first before they get into that.
All right. Since you have no objection, and I take it that you stipulated to it, I will certify Dr. Tabashneck as an expert in the area of forensic psychology.
Okay.
So she is an expert for purposes of...
Thanks, Dr. I appreciate it. So, Dr. Tabashneck, did you have a chance to evaluate me?
I did. Would it be okay if I reference my report?
Do you have any objection to that?
No objection, Your Honor.
You may. And I take it everybody has this report.
Would you, Your Honor, the state provided Mr. Holloway just to make sure I'll...
Thank you.
And I'm sorry, what was your question?
So my question was, what were your diagnoses of that evaluation?
My diagnoses were post-traumatic stress disorder and a paranoid personality disorder.
And can you briefly tell me what gave you that conclusion? Anything specific that gave you that conclusion?
Yes, so for the diagnosis of PTSD or post-traumatic stress disorder, there was a history of exposure to significant violence that you sustained during childhood and during adulthood. There were several criteria that you met in the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders that included flashbacks, interruptions in your sleep, nightmares, pervasive hypervigilance, and also hyperarousal, so feeling sort of persistently nervous and heart racing around perceived threats.
Thank you. And did I mention child abuse from my biological father at any point?
Yes, you did.
And could you describe your conclusion for could you describe my emotional diagnoses?
Yeah, so for the paranoid personality disorder, that disorder is characterized by a pervasive feeling of distrust of the world, so feeling constantly on edge, perceiving others as sort of inherently threatening, viewing sort of neutral cues as threatening, and sort of feeling like the world is out to get you.
Thank you. And I believe there was a part where you mentioned that in your reports I told you that I would like to be successful. Is that correct?
Yes.
So do you recall that conversation when you asked me if I would, what would I like to do in life? And I responded that I would like to be successful.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And there was another part where you mentioned your overall decision. Do you remember your overall decision on that from your report?
So I want to be clear that this evaluation was a preliminary draft of a report, so I had not completed the evaluation. So there was additional testing that needed to be done. There were further records that I needed to review. So I just want to be clear, this is a draft of a report that was never finalized.
Okay, and in that small draft of an evaluation, you automatically seen that I suffered from PTSD and paranoia. Is that correct?
Yeah, so I completed, a relatively thorough diagnostic history of you, and I obtained a psychosocial history, meaning that I was able to get information about your childhood, your education, your medical status, your mental health, but I did not complete a full evaluation.
Okay, thank you. And what would you say I scored? Low, medium, high, average? What would you say that I scored on most of the tests?
So I administered, I believe, 4 or 5 tests. So one was the Wechsler Adult Intelligence Scale, which is a intelligence scale that looks at the domains of verbal comprehension, working memory, perceptual reasoning, and processing speed. With that, your verbal comprehension, or your ability to understand words and phrases and know basic information, was within the average range. So it was around, so the average is 100, and it was 102 was your score. And the other domains, they were in, I believe, the 70, can I reference my report?
Is that okay? Yes, you
may. Okay. So your working memory was an 89, which was in the 32nd percentile. The perceptual reasoning index was in the 14th percentile. And your processing speed was your lowest index, meaning that you scored in the 8th percentile. So there was a big discrepancy or difference in your index scores, which suggested that you would have some difficulty processing and interpreting nonverbal information, such as body language and facial expressions, which could contribute to also the hypervigilance for neutral cues that I discussed previously. So I administered that test. I also administered the Firestone Assessment of Violent Thoughts, the Structured Interview of Reported Symptoms, which is a malingering or feigning test, the Level of Service Case Management Inventory, which is used to determine criminogenic risks or criminal risks, and I gave the mental, a mini mental status exam.
Okay, thank you. And I just want to quote from this overall report. You indicated that I have symptoms consistent with post-traumatic stress disorder, paranoid personality disorder, and substance use disorder. Those symptoms cause me to maintain negative beliefs about others in the world around me and lead me to hypervigilant to threat. Lead me to be hypervigilant to threat. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. And with those results, sometimes I misread signals and engage in behaviors that are inappropriate and impulsive. Notably, I have never actively engage in intensive psychotherapy to address these extensive history of trauma, both in childhood and in adolescence. So altogether, my question would be, is that your final conclusion that In order for me to shift my behavior, it would require intensive trauma-informed mental health and substance use treatment to address the root cause of my antisocial conduct and to develop adaptive strategies and coping skills to manage daily life. Without that intervention, it is likely that my behavior will shift or improve. Is that correct?
So I would say that you're someone who's never received intensive treatment, even as a child, and so it's unclear what the gains would be from that treatment. So with the post-traumatic stress disorder, that is a illness that shows pretty good symptom resolution. With the paranoid personality disorder, it's unclear what that would look like if the PTSD was adequately addressed. But personality disorders tend to be more long-standing and less resistant to change over time.
Thank you. So my last question is fairly simple. Do you think, would you suggest that I follow mental health treatment?
So I did an evaluation in, I think 2019, and I haven't evaluated you since then, so I don't know what your mental health is today, but based on the extensive trauma that you experienced as a child, and if your symptoms are relatively similar to what they were then when I evaluated you, then I would say absolutely that I'd recommend intensive psychological treatment.
Okay, thank you, Your Honor. No further questions for Dr. Tabashneck.
Cross-examination.
Yes, Your Honor. Thank you. Good afternoon, Dr. Tabashneck.
Good afternoon.
So, Doctor, you conducted a forensic mental health evaluation on the defendant, Mr. Holloway.
That's correct, yes.
And that included a variety of things, fair?
Yes.
So you would have reviewed documents?
Yes, I reviewed some documents, but there were many documents I wasn't able to review because of the stage of the evaluation.
So you reviewed some documents, fair? So,
yes.
Okay. And you interviewed Mr. Holloway?
Yes.
And you administered some assessments to him, fair?
Yes.
And those would be like assessment screening tools.
There were some screening tools, but there were also some more in-depth assessments used.
So some were assessments only, right?
Yes.
And then some were tools you used to kind of evaluate. You use those tools to kind of evaluate the assessment? Is that fair?
So I would say more that there's screening tools, and once you have a positive or you spike on a screening tool, that necessitates or triggers more in-depth assessment. So I did some tools that were more in-depth, and then I used one screening tool, so which was just a preliminary sort of screener.
Okay. And you interviewed Mr. Holloway on two occasions, right, as
Correct.
Part of your evaluation?
Correct.
You interviewed him in February of 2020?
Can I reference my
you
report?
You absolutely Mr. Holloway has no objection.
No objection.
Go right ahead.
Okay. Yes, on February 19th, 2020, and March 4th, 2020, for approximately 6 hours and 30 minutes.
So when you're meeting with Mr. Holloway, it's not just a quick interaction and then you're out, fair?
Correct.
And you wrote a report, I think you testified on direct, it was actually a draft of your report, documenting your findings and conclusions from your evaluation, Mr. Holloway.
It was an incomplete report with preliminary conclusions, and I still needed more information.
And the incomplete report would have been dated July 21st, 2020. Do I have that right?
Yes, that's correct.
So when you're, the purpose of your evaluation, you'd agree with me, was not to determine whether or not Mr. Holloway was insane under the legal standard at the time of October 12th, 2019, right?
Sorry, can you restate that?
Yeah, that was a bad question. Your job, when you were evaluating Mr. Holloway, wasn't to evaluate him for what we call, like, insanity, right? Was he insane at the time that the crimes were committed? That wasn't your job at that point, right?
So at the time, I believe his attorney...
Let me stop right there.
Yeah, I don't
know. I'll rephrase it, because that wasn't, again, not a very good question for me. Your purpose was to conduct an overall mental health evaluation, right?
So I want to answer your question. I'm not sure about the if the attorney privilege applies. I'll just answer the question.
And I can rephrase it too, Dr. Tabashneck. you were asked to conduct an evaluation of Mr. Holloway, right?
Yes, correct.
And that evaluation included an evaluation of his mental health, right?
Yes.
And when you do these kind of mental health evaluations, you consider a variety of different factors about somebody.
Yes.
Right? You consider childhood history.
Yes.
Family history.
Yes.
Medical history.
Yes.
Relationship history.
Yes.
Education history.
Yes.
Any mental health history.
Yes.
Trauma history.
Yes.
So I want to go to your actual evaluation right now. We'll turn gears here. So part of your evaluation of Mr. Holloway, it included this psychological testing, right?
That's correct.
And there were multiple assessment tools that you utilized to engage in this psychological testing of Mr. Holloway, fair?
Yes, I used several assessments.
And some of those included the mini mental status exam, right?
Yes.
And that would be, I'll abbreviate, MMSE, fair?
Yes.
Okay. Another one was the personality assessment inventory.
Yes.
That's the PAI, we'll abbreviate, fair?
Yes.
And then you also administered the structured interview of reported symptoms, second edition. Right?
Correct.
And that's the SIRS-2 for abbreviation. Fair?
Correct.
Okay. I want to talk about the mini mental status exam that you administered on Mr. Holloway. That exam is an 11-question kind of assessment tool.
It's a screener. So it's a preliminary test, and then if you someone shows deficits on the screener, then additional testing is done to clarify or shed light on the deficits.
And would you agree that the MMSE, it measures really five areas of cognitive function?
I guess I'm not sure what you're talking about.
Sure. Can we pull up the part of your report that I'm going to reference to? So you'd agree with me that the mini mental status examination, it's an 11-question assessment that you have in your arsenal when you're evaluating people, right?
Yes.
Okay. And it tests five areas of cognitive function.
Correct.
Okay. Orientation.
Yes.
Registration.
Yes.
Attention.
Yes.
Calculation.
Yes.
I guess attention and calculation is for the same, right? Or they're coupled. Delayed recall.
Yes.
Okay, and language.
Yes.
And Mr. Holloway, his score on that was a 29 out of 30, right?
Correct.
And that indicated to you, it suggested that there was not a cognitive impairment present with Mr. Holloway.
So it was a screener, but at the time of the administration of the assessment, he did not evidence any cognitive impairments that were captured by the screener.
I want to move on to another test, the personality assessment inventory. Can you explain to the jury, what is the personality assessment inventory?
It is a self-report inventory that measures personality functioning and mental health functioning. And there's a number of different scales, including validity scales that measure whether someone is over-reporting symptoms, under-reporting, whether they're attending to all the test items, and so forth.
And can you explain to the jury, you said it was a self-report tool. What does it mean? What do you mean by that?
That means that, so in some psychological testing, there are performance-based assessments, or commonly known as projective assessments, where the person doesn't really know. There's not really sort of a facial validity to what they're doing. So you may be looking, I mean, the Rorschach is sort of one of the most commonly known assessment tools. It's called the Rorschach inkblot test. And for that type of test, you're looking at a blot, you're saying what it is, so you don't really know what's going on. But with self-report inventories, you're asked a simple question that's typically at between a second and eighth grade reading level, and you're just answering a straightforward question.
You referenced earlier, I think during cross-examination maybe just seconds ago, something about validity scales. Can you explain to the jury, what's a validity scale?
So a validity scale is a scale within the inventory or the test that tells the evaluator whether the person is, for example, attempting to portray themselves in a positive light, attempting to portray themselves in a negative light, whether they're endorsing symptoms that are really atypical, even with someone who has a mental health disorder, or if they're engaging in inconsistent responding, which means that they are sort of not really attending to the test and just trying to get through it and randomly selecting bubbles.
So, Doctor, one of obviously the personality assessment inventory assessment, that has validity scales within it, right?
Yes.
Okay. And one of those validity scales is known as the infrequency scale?
Correct.
Okay. And can you explain to the jury, what is the infrequency validity scale measure?
So the infrequency validity scale looks at symptoms that are not commonly endorsed by people even who have mental health disorders. And so if there's an elevation in that scale, you wonder about whether someone is reporting symptoms that are atypical, whether they're engaging in careless responding. So you can pick up on other validity scales if the person is sort of engaging in random responding, which could trigger an elevation in that scale. Or if they're trying to portray themselves in a negative light, that could overlap with the infrequency scale.
Mr. Holloway scored had an elevated score on the infrequency scale on the PAI. Would you agree with me on that?
Yes.
Okay. And because of that, it caused the test results for that assessment tool to be invalid, right?
Correct.
And they were not only invalid, but for you, they were, because of the elevated score, they were uninterpretable.
Yes, that's correct.
All right, I want to know the structured interview of reported symptoms.
Can I just give one caveat to that?
Sure, absolutely. Okay.
So he was, I believe, at the lowest number that you could possibly trip the scale, but it still was an elevation and caused the test to be invalidated.
All right, let's go to the structured interview of reported symptoms. And, Doctor, I can direct you and Mr. Holloway. I'm looking at page 15 of your report. So the structured interview of reported symptoms, it's a tool that is used to assess the feigning of symptoms. Fair?
That's correct.
And is another word, I guess, in your field for the feigning of symptoms malingering?
Yes.
Can you explain for the jury generally what does malingering mean?
Yes. So when someone is malingering, they are either presenting symptoms that they don't have or they're exaggerating symptoms. Some people, they have an actual mental health disorder, but they're exaggerating certain symptoms of their mental health disorder that maybe don't, that is also co-occurring alongside their mental health disorder. But in general, malingering refers to someone who is trying to portray symptoms that they do not actually have.
So and I'm going to refer to it as the SIRS-2, that's an assessment of kind of deliberate misrepresentations or distortions in the self-report of symptoms for the patient, right?
Yes.
And you administer the SIRS-2 tool to the defendant as part of the psychological testing process.
Yes, I did.
Okay. How did Mr. Holloway score on the SIRS-2?
So I didn't include the test results in my report. It was a preliminary report. I do have the test results. I'm happy to pull out. I just need to get them from my file. Is that okay? Or
Your Honor, I think at this point, if she has those, I don't think we have them, and I'm going to guess Mr. Holloway doesn't have them, and so I think in fairness, we should both be able to take a look at it.
All right. If you're going to take a look at those, if you could just pull them out,
yep.
I'll have the state and Mr. Holloway review what you have for notes or documentation regarding the doctor. Thank you.
Yeah, sure.
And we'll have the state look at it and then pass it over to Mr. Holloway. Okay.
Thank you, Your Honor.
You're welcome.
So, Dr. Tabashneck, can you explain for the jury the scoring of the CERS 2 that Mr. Holloway and I were just able to look at.
Yes. When you say scoring, do you want me to discuss the test findings or something else?
How about, can you describe generally, generally for the jury, kind of how is the CERS 2 evaluation scored?
Okay, so there are, I believe, 8 scales, and there's also a inconsistency scale that measures whether there are different reports. So you're asked the same question basically twice over the course of the interview. So that is one of the scales. When there's scales, I can sort of list the different scales if that would be helpful.
I think it would be, yes, please.
Okay, so there's the rare symptom scale. There's the symptom combination scale. There's the blatant symptom scale. There's the severity scale. And then there are, let's see. I'm going to have to refer to the manual for some of these.
So I'll ask you another question.
Okay.
So based on Mr. Holloway's performance on the CERS 2, what, if any, findings did you make?
So Mr. Holloway elevated on, I think, four scales. So he elevated on the rare symptom scale, the symptom combination scale, which is a scale that measures sort of symptoms that wouldn't commonly co-occur together. A blatant symptom scale, which is symptoms that most people with major mental health issues don't have, and then on the severity scale, which suggests that he endorsed the severity of mental health problems that someone with a mental illness would not have. Again, on that scale, he was in the lowest point of probable fainting. And in all of these categories, he was in, I believe, the probable zone as opposed to the definite zone. Let me just check. Yes, that's correct. So for probable fainting as opposed to definite fainting, on 1, 2, 3, 4 scales, he was in, sorry, on 3 scales, he was in the indeterminable zone. And then in the 0, for one of them, he was in the non-fainting zone.
So just to clarify for the jury, how many scales did Mr. Holloway score probable fainting symptoms?
4.
All right. Let me turn your attention now. Mr. Holloway asked you about some kind of preliminary diagnoses of his mental health that you made during your evaluation, as a result of your evaluation. Remember that?
Yes.
Okay. And one of those diagnoses that you suggested is that he presented with symptoms consistent with paranoid personality disorder.
Correct.
Now, individuals with paranoid personality disorder, they perceive a need to exert a high level of control over their environment.
Yes, typically.
And they are wary of situations that are ambiguous or kind of unclear.
Yes, typically.
And individuals with paranoid personality disorder, they scan their environment and their social interactions to confirm negative aspects of people.
Yes.
But having paranoid personality disorder doesn't automatically render someone unable to, let's say, make their own decisions, right?
Yes, I would say that would be true of any mental health disorder.
Having paranoid personality disorder doesn't automatically render someone unable to distinguish right from wrong, right?
Yes, like any other mental health disorder.
And having paranoid personality disorder does not automatically render someone unable to understand the nature of their actions.
Correct.
If I may have a moment, Your Honor.
Yeah.
I have nothing further, Your Honor. Thank you, Dr. Thank you.
Any redirect at all?
Yes, Your Honor. Thank you.
Right ahead.
Dr. Tabashneck, did you also diagnose him with substance abuse disorder?
Yes, there were concerns about substance use disorder, I believe, alcohol, cocaine, and heroin, and cannabis.
Okay. So if I was under the influence, would that affect the defects that I would be suffering from if they were to be true?
I'm sorry, when you say defects, do you mean would it exacerbate underlying mental health symptoms?
Yes.
Yes, substances could increase the severity of mental health symptoms.
So it would increase the severity of the mental health symptoms, correct?
It could, especially depending on the substance.
So my question would be, is it possible that someone with natural life skills for adapting to society could suffer from these mental illnesses and still manage a normal life?
Yes, I think it would be, it could be sort of a painful life and at times a sad life, but there are plenty of people who are navigating the world with these conditions and holding jobs and functioning.
Okay, thank you. And another question would be, if someone who was suffering from these particular symptoms and diagnoses in any sense, would it be possible that some sort of happiness in their life at the time would be medicating?
Yeah, so for people who have post-traumatic stress disorder, they're at much higher risk of developing a substance use disorder. So the areas of the brain that are affected by PTSD, it's sort of counterbalance, the substance is sort of in the moment, counterbalance those areas. So for someone who, for example, has lower dopamine levels, they're feeling really sad, they're feeling anxious, substances temporarily increase dopamine and make someone feel more calm, more happy. So many people with mental health disorders self-medicate by using substances.
Thank you. And if you take away that happiness, that exact happiness, that pure happiness that was medicating those illnesses, is it fair to say that someone suffering from these illnesses would snap?
So I think for some people who abruptly stop substances, there can be collateral effects of that. So for example, people who are using methamphetamines and they abruptly stop using, they can become very violent and aggressive. But what we know about substance use disorder in general is that when people don't use substances for a prolonged period of time, so after a year, they're more neurobiologically similar to someone who's never had a substance use disorder than someone who has a substance use disorder. So it basically depends on the time frame that you're talking about.
Okay, thank you. And in that interview, that evaluation, did I mention that I smoked K2 substance while incarcerated?
Yes, I do remember that you had used K2 for many years.
Okay, and do you know if any of the side effects of that would be collaborative with what you just described as someone who stopped taking something and would have a reaction to it?
Well, synthetic cannabis is very bad for the brain and triggers a number of negative effects. I don't know, I'm not familiar with the literature on the abrupt cessation of stopping, or the abrupt stopping of synthetic marijuana and the effects of that, but I would imagine it would be uncomfortable.
Okay, thank you. And my last question would just be, is it possible that someone suffering from these illnesses could still be respectful, courteous, and pleasant?
Yes.
Thank you, Your Honor. No further questions.
May we cross
about? No, Your Honor. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ewers.
Thank you.
Sure where we're at in terms of witnesses at this point. Are there other witnesses available today or not? I think they're all available tomorrow morning.
That's correct, Your Honor. The state doesn't have anybody available for this afternoon.
Okay.
And I don't need Your Honor.
All right. Very good. All right. Since we've run out of witnesses for the day, it's been quite a day for you in terms of the deliberations and two phases of the trial. The first and the second one that you have completed, and now on to the third. So you've been multitasking all over the place today. I'm sure you're tired. So we're going to let you go early today, about a half hour early, and we'll have you come in at your usual time, 9:30 tomorrow morning, where we'll continue this phase. I know you've been in deliberations twice, and you have completed them, but you're still in the midst of this trial, specifically the insanity phase of the trial, so all the rules still apply. No discussion of the case at this point with each other regarding the insanity issues or with anyone else. No independent research as it relates to this phase of the trial, and no contact with the attorneys or Mr. Holloway. Enjoy your dinner tonight and your evening. We'll see you back at 9:30 tomorrow morning. We do have a lineup of witnesses that we've already worked on with cooperation by the state and Mr. Holloway to get people along with Attorney Doctor.
All right, very good. Have a good evening.
All rise for the jury.